Hello everyone. So today we are going to talk about a very important term in rotational mechanics that is called as moment of inertia. Okay. Before going to the moment of inertia, let us talk about one or two things that are essential. Let us first talk about rigid body. Now suppose I have some arbitrary body over here, and now this body is made up of large number of particles. This is the distance between any two particles, suppose. Okay, now a body will be called as rigid if under the application of any amount of forces on the bodies, the distance between the two particles does not change, then the body is called to be rigid. So for example, if there are n number of forces acting on the body in random directions, still the distance between any two particles does not change, then the body is said to be rigid. Actually, in nature there is no body such as a rigid body, because under the application of large amount of forces, each and every body can get deformed. But if the amount of forces or the magnitude of forces is not that large enough, then even our stone or this wooden duster can be called as rigid body if the magnitude of force is not that large enough. Fine. Okay, so just put the heading rigid body and write down: a body is said to be rigid if the distance between the two particles of the bodies, if the distance between the two particles of the body does not change even when it is subjected to a force or forces of any magnitude. Okay, now the next thing we need to understand is the axis of rotation. Since we are going to study about rotational motion, we need to know what is the axis of rotation. Now suppose this is some random three-dimensional body that is rotating. Okay. Now as the body is rotating, the particles of these bodies will perform a circular motion. Okay. If you recall, we had discussed one thing, that suppose if I put a mark on one of the blades of the ceiling fan and switch on the ceiling fan, then the entire fan will perform rotational motion. But if you observe carefully at the mark that you have put on the blade, the mark will perform a circular motion. In the same way, different particles of the fan will perform circular motion in different radius. Okay? Okay. In the same way, this body is made up of large number of particles. Suppose this is our first particle. Now suppose this body is performing a rotational motion. So this particle will perform a circular motion. The center of this circular motion will be somewhere over here. Okay? Now this is a three-dimensional body. So this circular motion that I have shown is in this sense. The plane of the circular motion is parallel to the floor. Okay, this is a three-dimensional diagram I am trying to draw. Okay. So suppose this is the center of that circular motion, the point over here. So this will be the radius of that circular motion. Let us say R1. If I take another particle, suppose that is over here, let us say second particle. So even he will perform a circular motion. If the body is rotating in this sense, the particles will perform circular motion also in that sense. So the second particle will perform circular motion in this sense. Again, its center will be somewhere over here. Its radius will be different, may be different. Let us say it is R2. In the same way, different particles will perform circular motion with different radius. Now the uniqueness of all these circular motions is that the centers of all these circles will lie on an imaginary line. The centers of all these circles will lie on an imaginary line. That line is called as axis of rotation. So I can draw a line which can pass through all these centers this line is called as axis of rotation. Fine? And the body is said to be performing rotational motion about this axis. Okay? So, as you can see, every particle, I mean, except the particles on the axis itself, if the particle, for the particles exactly on the axis, they will not perform any circular motion, right? Because they are itself on the axis. Their radius will be zero. But all other particles, apart from the, away from the axis, they will perform circular motion with different radius. Okay? And all this circular motion plane will be parallel to each other. Getting this? So this is about the axis of rotational motion. Okay, now if I rotate the pen like this, its axis of rotation will pass through its center in this manner, right? Now our earth performs rotational motion. It performs two types of rotational motion simultaneously. One is the motion about itself. In that case, where the axis of rotation is, it will pass through its center. Right? And the other motion is rotating around the sun. For that motion, its axis of rotation will pass through the center of the sun. You know? Getting this? Okay. For example, if I rotate this duster in this manner, the axis of rotation of this duster is passing like this. But I can also rotate the duster like this. For this rotational motion, the axis of rotation is passing through my shoulder. Okay, so I hope you understand what is the axis of rotation. Yeah, so put the heading axis of rotation and you can draw this diagram. And write down, whenever a body is performing pure rotational motion, every particle of the body performs circular motion. In bracket, write down, except those lying on the axis, bracket close. Then in the next line, write down, a line passing through the center of all this circular motion is called as axis of rotation. Okay? Okay. So this was about rigid body and axis of rotation. Now we'll get to what we want to discuss is moment of inertia. Okay. Okay. Now let us talk about inertia that we have already studied in a standard or 9th standard. What is inertia? Inertia is the tendency of a body. Inertia is the tendency of a body to remain in the state of rest or of uniform motion. Okay? So basically, inertia is the opposition provided by the body to change its state. For example, if suppose I have two masses. Now here we are talking about inertia. Okay? And more specifically about translation inertia. Okay. Now suppose if I have two bodies, one is mass m, small m, and other body is suppose is of greater mass, capital M. So capital M is greater than small m. First, let us talk about inertia, translation inertia. Then the things are analogous to understand moment of inertia. Okay. Now, once again, I am saying that I have two masses, a smaller mass and a larger mass. Both are at rest. Okay. Now, if I want to throw both of them such that both of them start moving with the same velocity, such that both of them move with the same velocity, So I will have to put some efforts to both of them. I will have to spend some energy on both of them. Okay? Let us do it one by one. So I am throwing this object such that this object of mass m is now moving with velocity v. Now, as per Newton's law, it will start moving, it will keep on moving with the velocity v. Now, let us forget that there is some gravitational force over here. Okay, or let us say in the absence of gravitational force, this will happen. So, over here in this region, I have put some efforts to this body such that it has now started moving with velocity v. And it will keep on moving with some with the same velocity v. Okay? So I have put some effort over here. Okay. Now, what will be the kinetic energy of this body? Let us say this is the first body. And this is the second body. Now, kinetic energy of the first body will be how much? Half m v square. Right? Okay. Now, look here. Now we know that energy cannot be created, nor it can be destroyed. Now over here, it was initially at rest, it didn't have any kinetic energy, the kinetic energy was zero. Now when it is moving, it has some kinetic energy, that is half m v square. So from where has this energy, from where is this energy coming from? From the efforts that I have put in. I have put some effort over here, no? I am talking in simple terms. That means I have spent some energy. That same energy is now in the form of kinetic energy in the body. I have lost some energy and the body has gained that energy. Simple? Okay. Now, let us throw the second body now of mass capital M. This is a heavier body. Okay, or more massive body than this body. Now again, I am putting such efforts that even this body now is moving with the same velocity v as the lighter body. Okay, now how much kinetic energy will it have? Half capital M v squared. Okay. Now you can easily see that second body's kinetic energy is greater than first body's kinetic energy. Why? Because obviously over here I will have to put more effort to it than over here. So over here I had to put less effort or spend less energy. Over here I had to put more effort or spend more energy. And the same energies are now in the form of kinetic energy. Okay? Now look here. Initially both of them were at rest. Now both of them are moving with the same velocity v. But who provided me more opposition for this motion? Or where did I have to spend more energy? For the second body, right? So who had more tendency to remain at the rest? Second body. Why? Because it had more mass. So we will say that a body with higher mass has more inertia than the body with lower mass. Because more inertia, more was the opposition for motion. And hence I had to spend more energy. And hence, it has more kinetic energy as it is moving than the other body. So in short, more inertia, hence more effort I had to put, more energy I had to spend. Hence, that body will have more energy with it. Okay? Now, in this formula, this half and half is same, this V and this V is also same, but his kinetic energy is greater than his kinetic energy because I have to spend more energy over here. So what exactly is more over here? the mass is more over here as compared to this mass. So is this clear? It was because more the mass, and hence I had to spend more energy. Lesser the mass, lesser energy. So mass is basically the measure of inertia. Mass is the measure of translation inertia. More the mass, more the inertia. Fine. Now, in the similar way, we will try to understand what is rotational inertia. This was about translation inertia. Okay? Yeah. Now, let us say I have two objects. Now, I will draw it over here because I require this space for some derivation. Now, suppose I have two bodies like this. Okay? Any two random bodies. Okay. Now, suppose these are its axis of rotations. Now, both of them are at rest. They are not rotating. Okay. Now, in order to make it rotate, both the bodies, I will have to put some efforts to the bodies in the form of torque. Anyway, I have to, as I had to do, I had to put efforts in the form of force. In the same way, to rotate the body, I will have to put effort in the form of torque. Anyway, so I will have to put some effort to this body to make it rotate about this axis with angular velocity omega. In the same way, to make it this body rotate with the same angular velocity omega, I will have to put effort even to this body. Now, suppose if I find that this was easier and this was difficult, that means I had to spend lesser energy over here to make it rotate with omega, and more energy over here to make it rotate with the same omega. Now, as they are rotating, they are rotating with omega, they will keep on rotating with omega. We are not considering any frictional losses. Okay? But as we were discussing, I had spent lesser energy over here to make it rotate with omega, and more energy over here to make it rotate with omega. That means that we will say that this body has more rotational inertia as this body, because I had to spend more energy over here. So it is clear that this body has more inertia, more rotational inertia as compared to this body. Fine? Okay. Now, lesser energy spent over here, that means now less energy will be there in the body. More energy spent over here, that means more energy will be there in this body. Now, this, what will be the form of energy in this body? It will be rotational kinetic energy. Okay? So, rotational kinetic energy, KER, let us say, of the first body will be lesser than rotational kinetic energy of the rotational kinetic energy of the second body. Why? Because it offered me lesser resistance to rotation. It offered me more resistance to rotation. Hence, over here I had to spend lesser energy. Over here I had to spend more energy. Hence, energy with this is lesser, energy with this is more. I hope you are getting this. Fine? Okay. Now, as in the previous case, this second body's kinetic energy was greater than the first body's kinetic energy. Why? Because this offered me more resistance, or I had to spend more energy over here because it had more inertia and it had lesser inertia, and hence his kinetic energy was greater than his kinetic energy. But what exactly was greater over here? Mass was greater over here as compared to here. And hence we say that mass is the measure of inertia, or mass is the measure of translation inertia. In the same analogy, over here, if we know the formula for rotational kinetic energy, then we can compare the formula of first body with the second body. And then we can say what exactly over here is lesser as compared to over here. that exact term will be the formula for rotational inertia, or it is also called as moment of inertia. Okay, so our next step is to find out the kinetic energy of rotating body. Now it is very simple. Now look here. Suppose I have this body, and suppose this is the axis of rotation. This is the axis of rotation. That means the axis is perpendicular to this board, like this. Okay, the axis is perpendicular to this board, like this. Okay. Now I want to find out rotational kinetic energy of this body. Now again, this body is made up of large number of particles. Let us say 1, 2, and n. N is the last particle, let us say. So we will say that the body is made up of n number of particles. Okay. So as this body is rotating about this axis, suppose the body is rotating with some constant angular velocity, omega. Okay. Okay. Now as this body is rotating about this axis like this, these particles will perform circular motion as we have discussed. So I'm just showing some part of the arc. So the radius of this first particle, let us say R1, radius of the second particle performing the circular motion, let us say R2, radius of the nth particle performing circular motion, let us say Rn. So first particle will move in this sense, second particle will move in this sense, and the nth particle will move in this sense, and so on, as we cover the entire body. Okay. Now we, as you can see, the body, the linear velocity of the body can be drawn tangential to this arc. Its velocity will be what? Let's say v1. Second's velocity will be v2, and the nth body's velocity will be vn. Okay. Now, as these bodies are moving in motion, circular motion, we can say that they have kinetic energies. Kinetic energy of the first body will be half m1 b1 square. But we know the relation between V and R. We know that V is equal to R omega, right? Now each and every body is moving with the same angular velocity omega, because each and every body is completing one circular motion in the same time, right? Okay. So for first body, kinetic energy will be half m1 b1 square, and V, since v1 is R, since V is R omega, V1 will be R1 omega. So it will be what? Half M1 R1 square omega square. In the same way, kinetic energy for second particle will be half M2 R2 square omega square. In the same way, kinetic energy for the nth particle will be half MN RN square omega square. Now kinetic energy is a scalar quantity. So to find out the total kinetic energy of the body or rotational kinetic energy of the body, we just have to add all these kinetic energies. And hence the kinetic energy, rotational kinetic energy of the body is nothing but summation of all these things. Now as you can see, if I have to add all these things, so what are the things common over here? Half and omega square is common. So I will take half and omega square out of the bracket. So I am writing omega square over here. So what we have in this bracket? M1 R1 square plus dot 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 MN RN square. M1 R1 square plus M2 R2 square plus M3 R3 square plus dot 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 MN RN square. Okay? Okay. So can I write this? Can I also write this as half in bracket summation of MI RI square omega square, where here I varies from 1 to n. So basically in this bracket we have summation of all these terms, na? Which terms? MR square, starting from M1 R1 M2 R2 and so on. So in short, I have written summation of MI RI square, where I varies from 1 to n. So basically in this bracket I have M1 R1 square plus M2 R2 square plus dot 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 MN RN square. Okay, so this is the formula of kinetic energy that we have got. So our half of the job is done. Okay. Now let us put this formula over here. So kinetic energy of the first, rotational kinetic energy of this first body will be what? Half summation of mi ri square omega square. Again, this will be lesser than kinetic energy of the second, rotational kinetic energy of the second body. And that is nothing but half into summation of mi ri square omega square. Okay. Now, why I haven't put omega 1 and omega 2 over here? Because I have said that both of them are now rotating with the same angular velocity, omega. Now, I hope you recall what we have just discussed. Kinetic energy of this, rotational kinetic energy of this was lesser than this. Why? Because it offered me lesser resistance and hence I had to spend lesser energy over here, and it offered me more resistance and hence I had to spend more energy over here. Lesser resistance means it has less rotational inertia. It has more rotational inertia. Less rotational inertia means less kinetic energy with it. Okay? Okay. Now what exactly is lesser over here than here? Let us see. Now half and half is constant. Omega square over here is also same. So what exactly is lesser here as compared to here is this term. Summation of mi ri square. This term, summation of mi ri square. This term exactly is lesser over here and more over here. And hence, this term will be called as rotational inertia or moment of inertia. Because this will tell me how much the body will offer resistance to be for rotational motion. Okay. Now what is this term? Mi ri square. So it is the summation of product of mass of each particle multiplied by its square of distance from the axis of rotation. Okay. So what is moment of inertia? Summation of mi ri square. Moment of inertia or rotational inertia. Or it is simply denoted by the letter I. This come out to be what? Summation of mi ri square, where I varies from 1 to n. So it not only depends on the masses of the particles, but also depends on the distribution of the particles from the axis of rotation. Okay? Now let me give you an example. Now let us say I have this body over here and I can rotate this body in this sense. Suppose then this will be the axis of rotation and I have the same body but now oriented in this sense, and now I am rotating this body such that this is the axis of rotation. Now in both the cases the bodies are same, so the masses of each particles of the body will also be same. But still, whose moment of inertia will be greater? This moment of inertia over here will be greater than over here. Why? Because even though the masses of the particles over here is same, still the particles over here are at comparatively at a larger distance from the axis as compared to the particles over here, as you can see. And hence, this will have a more moment of inertia as compared to this orientation. Okay, so moment of inertia depends on how your axis of rotation is. Okay, for example, the same thing I have shown, this was the body in this sense. So for to rotate the body in this sense, I have to apply some efforts. And if I can also rotate this body in this sense. So as you can also check this yourself, the body about this axis of rotation, it is more difficult to rotate as compared to this axis of rotation. About this axis of rotation, it becomes easier to rotate. About this axis of rotation, it is difficult to rotate. You can feel that in your own hands. See? So I hope you have understood this term, moment of inertia, or rotational inertia, or simply denoted by the letter I. Okay, sure. Thank you.